Amen. You may be seated. You may be seated. Welcome again to Connect Us Church. There we go. Our mission is to connect you to God's next step for your life. And it's always exciting to celebrate people when they do that. And certainly dedicating your children to the Lord is an incredible next step to take if you have little ones. We're going to be doing another one of these types of services, not the whole thing, but you know, a little section of it in the coming weeks. So you could continue to think about that as well. But maybe for you, your next step is to fill out that connection card that you should have received when you came in today. Now is a great time to do that. Write your name on there, a way to contact you. You can drop it in the offering box, which is over here, or you can put it in the lobby hallway as well. There's a box. But if you've never filled it out before, don't put it in the box. Take it out with you into the lobby. We've got a new here area where we'd love to meet you and give you a free gift in exchange for that connection card. And we'd love to do that for you. And then what we're going to do is we're going to invite you to something called First Step, which is a group that happens after the service every single week, where we just want to get to know you, answer your questions, and to do anything that we can do to connect you to God's next step for your life. And so today, that's going to be in theater number 4, which you leave here, you turn left, and it's on the right-hand side. So I encourage you to join us for that if you haven't done that before. And for those who give, your generosity connects people to God's next step for their life. It's a special thing to be able to celebrate God at work. And so your financial generosity fuels that. We give online, we mail a check, and we give in person. And again, thank you to making all of that possible. Today, we start a brand new series called Questioning Faith. And it's only going to be a relatively short message today because of all the other exciting things we did in our service. And there's always more to say about something after a sermon. Can you believe that? You can't squeeze it all into just 45 minutes or whatever it is, right? There's always more. And one of the things that we're going to be doing for the first time is we're going to be doing a live stream during the week. Me and Mr. John Munchell will be live on Facebook and YouTube on Monday night, tomorrow night at 8:45 p.m. And we're going to be talking more about the message today. And throughout the last month or so, we've been collecting your questions. And we just can't answer all of your questions at a format like this. And so on Monday night, there's like a series of 4 questions that we won't answer today, but we'll answer them then. And so if you can join us live, that would be awesome. You can comment, we'll interact as best as that online platform allows. But if you can't join us at that particular time, it'll just live on the internet and you can watch it at any time. And if you comment later, I guarantee I'll do my best to comment back to you at some point in time too. So you can join us for that. I'm really looking forward to it. And it's really cool that we kicked off this Questioning Faith series with our child dedication service because kids ask great questions, don't they? They're not really ashamed at all. They're just like, why, you know? And it could be anything that they say next. But it's really cool that Jesus said that the kingdom of God is for those that have faith like a child. And so there's something special about the way a child trusts and the way that a child has faith that is important to learn from them as those who are older. And so like when my little girls jump off of something and they expect me to catch them. Like, that's faith. That's trust. That's my daddy's not going to drop me. My daddy's not going to let me down. And we can do that by jumping off into whatever God is leading us to. And he's certainly going to catch us. He can be trusted. And so we ask questions like this one. Does God change his mind? It's a great question. And really, I think the question behind the question is this idea of, can God be trusted? Like, we know people that have changed their minds, right? Maybe you got a job and it was going to be a great job, and then the boss came to you who hired you like a couple weeks earlier and was like, I don't think this is going to work for you. It did 2 weeks ago. Or you've been at that company for years, 30, 40 years. You've invested your entire life to this company, and all of a sudden they're like, you're done. You changed your mind? Like that quick, right? We've all experienced that in relationships with friends. Hey, I'm going to be there for you. And they're not. They change their mind. Whether it's a spouse walking out, it's hard. It's really hard. They promise to be there. They promise to be with you. They promise to show up at that event, and they don't. For whatever reason, they changed their mind. And so what do you do when your trust decreases as a result of people changing their minds? Right? Your trust in them is not as strong as it once be, because maybe they're going to just choose differently today. Can they really be trusted? And so we ask that question about God. Can we trust God? Does God change his mind? Does God change his mind? And the short answer is no, God doesn't change his mind. In Malachi 3 verse 6, as we look to the scriptures, it says, I am the Lord, and I do not change. And that is why you descendants of Jacob are not already destroyed. Many other countries were destroyed because of their sin. And God's saying, I promised you something special. This isn't the time for that. I do not change. I'm not taking back my word. I do not change. Two other verses. James 1:17, whatever is good and perfect is a gift coming down to us from God our Father, who created all the lights in the heavens. He never changes or casts a shifting shadow. He never changes. And this one is very clear. Numbers 23:19, God is not a man so that he does not lie. He is not a human so that he does not change his mind, implying that humans change their mind. I change my mind. You change your mind. God does not change his mind. Has he ever spoken and failed to act? Has he ever promised and not carried it through? The answer to those rhetorical questions, everybody, is no. But it's contrasting a human, right? Is yes, like we've spoken things and we haven't done them. We've promised and we haven't carried through, but God is different. He does not change his mind. But what do you do about the handful of verses that seem to say the exact opposite? What do you do when you read a verse like Genesis 6:6, and it repented, which is literally like to change, to turn around, to change your mind? The Lord, it repented the Lord that he had made man on the earth, and it grieved him at his heart. This is at the very beginning, and human beings were very sinful, and God sent this flood to destroy everybody pretty much, except for a few people. Did God change his mind about his creation? Or in Jonah 3:10, when God saw that they had done and how they had put a stop to their evil ways, he changed his mind and did not carry out the destruction he had threatened. So one of them is like a negative. He changed his mind from good to bad, it seems. And the other one is like a positive. He changed his mind from bad to good. So what do you do with that? Seemingly opposite ideas. Well, one of the helpful things to do is to realize that the Bible was not written in English. And so if you can go back to the words that were translated into these words, it gives you an idea of why the translators translated these words the way that they did. And so when you look at Genesis 6:6 and Jonah 3:10, the word that is like change their mind is the Hebrew word naham, which means to repent, to change, and it also has this idea of bringing sorrow or to bring comfort. And so it's not like the word is like this and that's it, right? There's more context, there's more, you have to see how it's used in phrases and see how it all works together. And so that word naham is also like in a different translation, in the New Living Translation. The writers of the English version look at the Hebrew word and they try and figure out the context. And so in Genesis 6:6, so the Lord was sorry he had ever made them and put them on the earth. It broke his heart. They're trying to capture this idea of this Hebrew word that it's not like God like didn't foresee this happening. God is in control of all things. God does not change. He is immutable. That is the big theological term. But he feels emotion like you do. We're created in his image. And so he felt the pain that his creation that has free choice, because he wants a relationship with us, that they were choosing to do something that it broke God's heart. And that's captured in this idea of God changing his mind. And then like in Jonah 3:10, it's that same Hebrew word, naham. When God saw all that he had done and how they had put a stop to their evil ways, that's the city of Nineveh. This evil city of Nineveh, God told Jonah, the prophet, to go and tell them that they were going to be destroyed. And Jonah wanted them to be destroyed. Oh, he wanted it so bad. And when God changed his mind because the people actually changed their mind about God, Jonah was sitting up on the hill ready to see the city destroyed, and it wasn't. It's an amazing story. But God, Jonah, in 3:10 here, he writes, or it says, that he changed his mind, God did, and did not carry out the destruction he had threatened. And so if you look at that word, naham, again, in a different translation, the NIV translation from 30 years ago, when God saw what they did and how they turned from their evil ways, he had compassion and did not bring upon them the destruction he had threatened. And so you can see how when we look at the original language of the text and how you translate it, on the surface, they both can't be true, right? God doesn't change his mind. God does change his mind, right? They can't both be true. But when you understand it, when you study it, when you dig into it, when you see how it's applied in the context of the different writers and how it's used, you can come to an understanding that, in a sense, God can, he doesn't change his mind, but then there are certain things that he's changing, like his feelings, he's changing, he has compassion for people. And so the bottom line is that God is entirely consistent. He's entirely consistent. He does not change. He is consistent. And so when people turn from their evil ways, God changes his mind about them and is consistent to always forgive and always welcome into his family. But if somebody refuses to repent, to change their mind about God, then God is always consistent in his judgment. It's not like one day God decides, well, today the way you get to heaven is you believe in Jesus. And then the next day it's, well, you believe in, you know, a follower of Islam. And the next day it's you've been to church enough times. And the next day it's you've given enough money to the church. And the next day you've done enough good things. Like, it's not this random roulette of whatever God chooses. Like, God is entirely consistent in who he is and what he does. And so when we think about this idea of Genesis chapter 6 and God changing his mind about humanity, like, God created humans, and what did he call his creation? He called it good. And then it was very good. But then the people were bad. And that broke God's heart. And so we just wonder, we ask, like, did God make a mistake? Like, if he knew that humanity was going to be so evil that he was going to have to destroy pretty much everybody, did God make a mistake? And then we personalize it. Not just did God make a mistake, but did God make a mistake about me? We might wonder, am I a mistake? And in some ways, this is true. We've all made mistakes. We've all sinned. We've all fallen short of God's perfect standard. We're all sinners, and we're all separated from God. But God doesn't make mistakes. You're not a mistake. He does not change his mind. God is entirely consistent. And God wants to change his mind, in quotes, about you when you change your mind about him. Like, it broke God's heart to know that man had become so evil. And so he did something about it. Like, he's consistent that he judges sin. And in this particular instance, the consequence of sin came right then and there in God's sovereign judgment and love and justice. He just decided, like, you can't ever escape the consequences of your sin, no matter what it is. But in that moment, God was also looking ahead to the cross, where his one and only son, Jesus, would die on that cross to pay the penalty for your sin and the sin of the entire world so that they wouldn't have to. And God's not just going to forgive your sin because you showed up to church today. And God's not going to forgive your sin because you're a nice person. He's entirely consistent. And sin has to be paid for. And either you're going to pay for it, or you're going to believe that Jesus did for you. And so when we change our minds, when we turn, when we repent, when we look to Jesus instead of anything else, then he is entirely consistent about changing his mind towards us. He forgives our sins. He welcomes us into his family every single time. And that could be you this morning. Like, you could make that decision in these moments where, yes, you might feel far from God. Yes, you might have done things that make you feel like you've made a mistake, that you are a mistake. But God doesn't make mistakes. And yes, we might be far from him, but in our sin, God demonstrated his love by sending his son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross to pay the penalty for your sins so that anyone, and this includes you, who turns from their sin and trusts in Jesus will be forgiven and will have eternal life, abundant life. God wants to change his mind about you when you change your mind about him. So would you stand with me and close our service with me in a word of prayer? Lord Jesus, we are thankful that you love us and that it doesn't depend on how you're feeling today or how the weather is or even the decisions that we've made. God, you are who you are and you love us no matter what. And Lord, I just pray for those today that might feel like they've made mistakes, that they are a mistake, that they would know just how much you love them. That yes, there's consequences to sin, but yes, Jesus paid the ultimate consequence for us. And so, Lord, I just pray that we would trust and believe in you, Jesus. And for those that might be trusting and believing for the first time or the first time in a long time, I just pray that you would give them boldness and confidence to believe that it's not up to them. It's that you love them, Jesus, that you've forgiven them, and that you want to give them a new life, a fresh start. And you want to do that today. And we know that because you're consistent. That's what your word says. If we confess with our mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in our heart that you have been raised from the dead, we will be saved. And we can believe that. So thank you, Lord Jesus, that you are who you say you are and that we can trust you. In Jesus' name, amen. Thanks so much for being here today. It's so special, a special moment. We're going to continue the conversation, continue the message tomorrow night at 8:45 if you want to join us online. And before you leave, I'm going to play a song. You may leave as it goes, but it's one of my favorite kids songs. And if you've ever heard like the cha-cha slide or like the, it tells you how to do the dance. So you can do the dance if you want to. No pressure. Thanks so much for being here today. And we'll see you next time. Remember that connection card. And next week is Shame from My Past. That's the topic. Shame from my past. What do you do with that? Here you go. You are valuable. But what is the value of you? Like, if you could put a number on it, would be, what, $1 million? I mean, that seems like a lot, right? Maybe some of us find our value in our appearance. Or we find value in our status. We find value in our position at work. We can find value in all different kinds of places, but I think we should find our value from one person and one person alone. And that person is the one who created you, the one who made you, and the one who purchased you, the one who bought you. So you were created in the image of God, and you were purchased by God. So how much did God give to purchase you, to buy you back? How much did he give? Well, he gave everything that he possibly could, including his very own life. He purchased you with everything that he could. And so he died on that cross to pay the penalty for your sin. He paid for you and even his very life. And so we should find our value in the cross. We should find our value in the cross. Come me.
The house parents said that they're going to take time and pray for the writing of the Kenyan Constitution. Okay, again, context, these kids are between 3 and 7. They probably can't even say the word Constitution very well, or know what letter it starts with. But in that time, it wasn't some few minutes. We took about 20 minutes to a half hour, and these kids were just praying. They were just praying. Some were standing on seats, some were walking around, some are lying on the floor, just mimicking what they've seen their other parents and leaders do as they pray. Again, I don't know if they could pray for a constitution because they don't know what that is. But at the end of the day, the fact was these kids weren't waiting for the 20 minutes to be over. It wasn't just passing time. These kids were really, from their small little hearts, praying for the issues that were going on. For me, it was impactful. I think I was seated somewhere on the floor, and then I just remember these small little hands, you know, as the kids would walk around, just praying for Auntie Jordan and Auntie Jen, who is a friend of mine who was also there, and just taking a moment to be a fly on the wall and to look at these little kids, understanding they've come from extreme situations. Most of them, when they came to the Children's Center, were on their last breaths, and we didn't know if guys were gonna survive. And to see how they go from a situation like that to a situation just full of life because of Jesus, it really brought me to a place where I had to ask these questions that Kevin was asking. This faith that I've grown up with, this thing that I'm doing, is it really changing who I am? Is it really changing what I'm doing? Or is it just a box that I'm ticking? Because I don't need another thing in my life that's gonna just tick a box. You know, I need something that's going to be as real for me as praying for the Constitution that these kids were doing. And it was something for me coming from that trip specifically. It made me think, you know what? It has to be real. You know, and I remember praying and telling God, if this is not real, if this is not something authentic, then I don't want it. Because then it also is misleading to other people who are looking for something real. And I believe all of us are here because we're looking for that real connection. You know, we talk about